begin by reading a section of scripture, then praying, and then we're going to get into these notes and see how far we get. Let me read. I'm going to read for you out of Ephesians chapter 1. Listen as I begin reading in verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. Let's pray. Lord, it is an amazing thing for us to contemplate the mercy that you purposed for us before the foundation of the world, that in your kindness you had been pleased and purposed to give us to your Son, indeed even to send your Son that he might purchase our redemption and bring about our reconciliation, guaranteeing by the sending of your Spirit our salvation in the due time. Lord, we are so thankful for the grace that is ours in Christ. And I just pray this evening as we further continue to understand the things that your word says regarding the issue of election, that we would understand these things in a deeper way so that our hearts and minds would be just further humbled and struck with awe and love for the great love that you've poured out upon us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Now, last time we did not necessarily finish the entirety of the notes, but I encouraged you to go ahead and read through the rest of those yourself, and I'm going to encourage you to do that. I've also encouraged you to take the things that have been given and continue to go back and read them and reread through them. When you see the verses, make sure you open up your Bibles that you can see the verses in your Bibles, where it fits. What are the verses before it and afterwards? Are they saying what I say they're saying? Because ultimately, we must all be taught by the Word of God. And so take the Word of God, take these things with much prayer, and dig in. Today, as we consider part two in election, one of the things that we're going to be looking at as we move through here is Romans chapter 9. Romans chapter 9 is, for many, a frightening passage. There is, I know some students who graduated from a Bible college overseas, and because the president of that particular Bible college did not want to believe in election or want to believe in predestination, he forbid the students to ever read or discuss Romans chapter 9. And you begin to think, what kind of Bible college or Bible institute will forbid a chapter of the Bible? I mean, anything that's so strong and so powerful and so clear that people say, don't look at that or I'll never be able to convince you of my way. You don't want to go that way if the Bible is going to lead you a different direction. Romans chapter 9 is, the majority of that chapter is to teach us about God's sovereign divine rights to choose whomever he will for whatever he will. Okay, and so for us to understand the idea of election, that before the foundation of the world, he chose us in Christ for salvation. What Romans 9 does is it begins by showing a pattern of God having absolute authority to choose who he will. He'll choose one man out of the whole world, and then he'll choose one of his sons, and then he'll choose one of his sons. And you see God's sovereign selection exercised as he wills throughout history that you begin to hopefully recognize this is God. And he has the right to do this, and he actually did these previous elections for particular purposes and blessings and benefits in order to display that he is the one who has the right to make the selections as to who will be the recipients of his great love and mercy and be redeemed in Christ, and who will be left to carry on in their willful rebellion and sin. Okay? So I want us to begin to look at it. Romans chapter 9, verse 11 says this, though they were not yet born and had done nothing, either good or bad, in order that God's purpose of election might continue or might stand, not because of works, but because of his call. This historic event, twins being born and God selecting one for a special covenant relationship with him, a special blessing and servant in the world, a service in the world, and the other one not receiving that special blessing, not receiving that special promise. That happened historically, and the scripture says why? In order that God's purpose of election might continue. It was designed to demonstrate and display the divine rights of God in election. You know, which should help us. Now, generally, I want to note this, because this there's an emotional disconnect between you and me and Jacob and Esau. I mean, Jacob and Esau, they're far away, a different century. Whether God chose one or the other doesn't affect my life. So it's almost no one has difficulty with that election. It's when that election starts to affect me, and maybe it might where it might affect my children, or it might affect my loved ones, then it starts to be something that we emotionally have a response towards, and then maybe begin to rebel and reject. But so that we understand God's purposes of election continue, he has given historic demonstrations of that. And I want us to see that. And it's important to note this, and I put this in bold, bold, bold print. It's important for us to understand that the doctrine, the biblical truth and teaching of election, does not keep anyone out of heaven. Rather, it admits people to heaven. Because what does the scripture say? This is by way of a little bit of review. Romans chapter 3, verse 9 and following. How many are righteous? No, not one. How many understand? How many seek after God? None. So, if men were left to themselves in the natural outworking of the sinful condition, as Romans 1 says it, they suppress the truth in unrighteousness, which since no one is righteous, that means everyone is unrighteous and does what? Suppresses the truth even because they're not able to understand it. So then none would be saved had not God elected someone to salvation. So when someone wants to present the idea, I don't like the doctrine of election because it limits the number of people who are going to heaven, they've completely misunderstood the concept. Because apart from election, the number of people going to heaven is extremely limited. You know, it would ultimately be limited to Christ alone in terms of those who walk the face of this earth. Right? Because he's the only man who ever walked in perfect righteousness of God. Of course, being the Son of God, he was able to do so. So election doesn't limit the number of people in heaven. And actually what's confusing to so many is there's no difference. We will all say, those who want to choose not to believe in election and those who recognize the scripture's teaching on election, should both acknowledge this. Do you know who's going to be in heaven, the eternal heaven, new heaven and new earth with God forever. It is everyone who truly repents and believes in the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. Every single person who truly repents and believes will be saved. Is that not what they say too? Yes. The difference is not how many. Because then again, we already know the how many. The names have been written in the Lamb's Book of Life before the foundation of the world. So the difference is how their names got written. Were their names written because God looked at their future life and saw that they would do good? Well, then it wouldn't be by grace, it would be by works. Did he see who would believe? No, because again, the scriptures have shown us that would be zero. And so the Lamb's Book of Life is written on the complete basis of God's divine right to choose from among his entire creation and to make from among them a people for himself, a people for his own name that he would give to his son, and his son would come and redeem and reconcile to right relationship with God. So the number is fixed before the foundation of the world, and some want to say it's based on foresight, what they define as foreknowledge. But still, even then, but they say if you believe in the idea of election, that means that there's a lot of people who will never have a chance, because election means some people don't have a chance. That's not what election means. Election means wherein nobody would have any hope. Now in Christ, there is hope for all who believe. That's different. Because if men are completely left to their decisions, to their ideas, to foresight, again, it's none. There would be zero in the kingdom of heaven. So further, someone might say this, well, I don't like that. Well, all right, so let's say I allow your notion for just a moment. I allow your hypothetical that God is somehow bound by foresight, and in your imagination, God can foresee men in their own choices believing, which the Bible does not teach. But even if I allow that, the multitude of people that God foresaw would never believe and would die in their sin. When did they have a chance? At what point would have God's foresight of their willful faithlessness have been wrong? So whether it's foreseen or whether it's chosen, do men of their own have it? For example, if I'm one, was one who God could looked forward in time and saw I was never going to believe, then next year, is there a chance I might believe? 10 years from there, is there a chance I might believe? If God had foreseen that I would never believe in my lifetime, and thus he did not elect me, then even then would I really have a chance? I'm trying to show you that the philosophy of it breaks down. In this weird attempt to sort of exonerate God and paint him in the broad brushstrokes of man's idea of goodness, it's still this. God knew this person, that person. God knew all these millions and millions of people would be born, live their entire lives, die, never believing in him. Yes or no? When did he know those things? He's always known those things. And yet he still allowed them to be born, allowed them to be conceived. He allowed them to live and enter into a life where there was, even if you want to base it on foreknowledge, no hope, because he saw that they would never turn. So that's the worldview of those who are in the I don't believe in election camp. But that's not what the scripture teaches. The scripture teaches on the basis of sheer foresight, no one understands, no one's righteous, no one turns, and God in his mercy says, I am not abandoning the cosmos. I'm not abandoning the totality of my creation and all of the world, but I am going to work a work of redemption, a work of reconciliation, a work of salvation. I'm going to display my mercy. I'm going to pour out my compassion. I'm going to pour out my love, and I am going to save a multitude of people. People from every tongue, tribe, and nation throughout the earth, throughout the ages. And if he had not, there would be none. And so it's just important for us to see that. People get into all kinds of logical arguments. I don't like the doctrine of election because it means that so many people don't have a chance. If you, in order to argue that somebody has a chance, then you have to argue that God's knowledge was never complete before the foundation of the world. And if you're going to argue for a God who's not omniscient, yeah, you're no longer in Christianity. You're no longer even in the broad-based camp of the biblical faith. All right, let's dig in here. Romans chapter 9, I'm in the second paragraph now. Romans chapter 9 is one of the most difficult passages in Scripture. Some would say that you should not use difficult passages to teach doctrine. And I would generally agree that we should not use a passage or passages that are difficult to interpret or that are unclear to establish doctrine. But Romans 9 does not fit because it is easy to understand. The reason it's one of the most difficult passages in the scripture is not because it's one of the most difficult to understand, it's just one of the most difficult for men to accept. It's really easy to understand. You could read it to kids, and they will understand because it's wonderfully clear, even exemplified, demonstrated, simple language. And so, yes, complex passages with confusing words and things, be careful to establish your doctrine on those. But Romans 9 is not that kind of passage that when you read it, you don't know what it's saying. It's what happens is when a lot of people read it, they say, I don't know if I can believe this. I don't know if I accept this. I think I may have told you the story before. It's an old story that a man was visiting a barber whose wife went to the church, but he didn't go to the church because it was a church that believed in election, and the guy didn't grow up that way. And so while getting his haircut, he said, but do you believe the Bible? And he said, well, yes, I believe the Bible. I just don't believe the doctrine you guys teach at your church. All right, well, but you do believe the Bible? Yes. Let me read for you a chapter. And he read for him Romans chapter 9. And he said, do you believe that? And the barber said, not the way you read it. But that doesn't work, does it? Because when you read it, and it's really clear, and you've got no more excuses and nowhere to go, you can't blame the guy who was just reading the scripture. And that's why this passage was banned from a Bible institute that did not want the students to accept the doctrine of election. I was speaking recently with a young man who said that Romans 9 was one of the chapters that as he began to study it and work through it, it's one of those chapters that moved him to stop struggling against what God's Word so clearly teaches. And so I want us to begin to dig into this. Now the first thing I want us to understand is God elected or chose Abraham. Now, when you're reading through Genesis, it doesn't say that God chose Abraham in the book of Genesis, and it doesn't technically say that in the book of Romans either. But what you do have is God called Abraham. But why did God call Abraham? How many people were there on the face of the earth? I don't know, but obviously more than a handful. And so why did God call Abraham and not somebody else? Now, someone might say, well, because Abraham was better than other people. Was he? How was Abraham better? See, we don't have any idea much about what Abraham was before God called him and before he came out into the land of the out of Ur of the Chaldeans. We have no idea what he was before, but we do have an idea what he was after he was called out. After he's called out, he gets into a situation where he's going to be a little bit dependent on the local king and leadership. And he looks over at his wife, Sarah, and says, she is beautiful. They will kill me in order to get her. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell them she's my sister. And I'm going to let them take her to their house. Is that something that you think, that's a good guy right there? You know? When I read that, to me, a good guy says, you know what? They're going to have to kill me before they take her. There is no way that they're taking her and defiling her as long as I'm alive. It's not what he said. And if you read the scriptures, he did it not once, but twice. Two times. Now, each of those times, God intervened to protect her and to keep her from being violated. But no good in him. The only one seeming supposed good thing that he did really in that process was he obeyed God in that he was willing to sacrifice his only son. But the scriptures tell us even that that was actually an act of faith. His faith counted to him as righteousness. And so there was no righteousness that was in him. He wasn't a good man. And Nehemiah 7:9 verse 7 says this, you are the Lord, the God who chose Abraham and brought him out of Ur of the Chaldeans, Abram, and gave him the name Abraham. So he would become a father of many nations, Abraham. So that the change of his name from what would seem small time to what would be big time. But what's interesting to note is this. It says God chose him and brought him out. But it's possible if you would have interviewed Abraham, he would have said, God called me. He offered me a covenant, you know. And I accepted and I came out. It was my act. It was my decision. I did it. God said, come out over here to the land that I will show you, and I went. And he's not wrong. God said, come, and he went. But you know what he may have and we may have failed to do? Why did he respond to God's call to come out? And Nehemiah makes it clear, because God brought him out, which meant that which made him willing, that brought about his following, was not simply him. It wasn't God chose him and then Abraham accepted the choice. It wasn't just that God called him and Abraham accepted the call. To really understand the totality of what really happened, God chose him, God brought him out. And this is, you're going to face this a lot because you're going to talk to people and they're going to tell you, no, I can't believe what you're saying about election, even as it says in John 6, no one comes to me unless the Father draws him. Well, no one, that idea, they'll say, I know that's not true because I remember when I made a decision. I remember when I made a choice. Yeah, so did Abraham. So did Abraham come out of that land, or was he brought out? Do you see the confusion? He's brought out by God making his heart willing to come, willing to follow. So that effectively, when someone says, but I remember and it was my decision, Yes, it was. And why did you make that decision that day and not a month before? For some people, it was not the first time they heard the gospel. Why didn't you make a decision the first time you heard the gospel? What did you learn in between that time and another time? What changed? Well, I was going through a really hard time. Oh, so because you were sad and needed a little bit of help, now you were ready? Is that how it worked? No, what we come to realize is this, and if you go ask enough people, you'll realize, well, yeah, there was, for some, they'll say, there was nothing different about that day. I mean, I wasn't going through a harder time. I wasn't in a deeper need. So what made a difference between one person and another, why one believed, one day and another, how come we believed that day? And we would come to understand it's very much like what it says here in Nehemiah. That's the day the Lord brought you out. That's the day God had destined for you. And we're going to see that when we dig in here a little further. And so we got to start digging into it. People don't usually stop and ask why, but they should. Now go with me too, and your Bibles, if you want them open, can be open to Romans chapter 9, because we'll be going back and forth between the notes and that text. In Romans chapter 9, verse 7, it says this, "Not all the children of Abraham, not all are children of Abraham because they are his offspring, but through Isaac shall your offspring be named." Now, we want to start from a human perspective also. Already you got to start saying, well, that's not fair. I mean, if he has another kid, and that Ishmael, and that kid is his actual offspring, having his DNA, maybe even looking like him, how dare the scripture say, nope, that's not how it's going to be considered? Or, more than the scriptures, how dare God say? Does God have the right to say, these ones, even though they may be your physical children, they are not going to count for my purposes? You know what else he didn't do? Abraham, I gave you two kids. Make your choice. Which one? You get to choose one. Which one will it be? He didn't give it to Abraham. Why? Because the right of election belongs to God, not to men. Not to men for their own actions and decisions. So ultimately, we could say the reason why Abraham was called and the reason why Abraham came is because God had elected him to that purpose. And so the divine working chose him, called him, brought him, and he came. So you have both the experience of what man is doing, but it's the outworking of what God is doing. Does that make sense? I hope so. Abraham had another son, Ishmael, 13 years before, and both of them were technically the children of Abraham, weren't they? But one was chosen and not the other. It was through one that would be the offspring. The other one was cut off from the covenant of promise. Now, again, as we begin to go through this, some people will say, well, I don't have a problem with that because, I mean, Hagar was the mother. She was a slave woman. She was, an Egyptian, so she wasn't a Jew. Well, I just got to clue people in at this point. Abraham wasn't a Jew, and neither was Sarah. Because Jews didn't exist. Because it was going to be his grandson's offspring that would later be called the Hebrews or the Jews. So some people, it's amazing how we read things backwards and say, well, it makes sense that Sarah was the one that it was her baby because, I mean, they were both Jews. What are you talking about? They were not Jews. They were Chaldeans. And so, but we'll rationalize it. Okay, the reason why God chose this son and not the Isaac and not Ishmael, here's the reason why. Because he was the child of his first wife, his first love, his real wife. And so we'll come up with a reason, because if we can't come up with a reason for God's divine election, it makes us uncomfortable. But the scripture does not give us a reason in this passage, other than God's declaration. But because, and this is such a beautiful thing, because of God's wonderful wisdom in knowing how we will seek to rationalize and twist it, he piles example on example till all of our excuses fall away and we have to fall to our knees and say, yeah, election is all of God's divine will. Look at what it says coming down. Even avoiding confusion, look at God elected not only Abraham, and then God elected Isaac, God elected Jacob. Romans chapter 9, verse 10 through 13 says this. Not only so, but also when had conceived children by one man, our forefather Isaac. Okay, so everyone's coming up with a reason. The reason why Isaac was chosen is because, you know, Sarah was the special one. All right, so the second example of election, so that no excuses can be there, same daddy, same mommy. Okay, so you can't say he chose this one or that one because it was the first marriage, and that's the only one God recognized. You know, you can't argue that, because he's choosing with the same father, the same mother, and he's choosing before they were born, and not on the basis of anything that they had done or would do. Because what had they done so far? Yeah, nothing. They weren't even born. So that though they were not yet born and had done nothing, either good or bad, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, in order that we would learn that God has the divine rights of election and exercises those rights, not because of works. So realize, though they hadn't done works yet, and someone might say, yeah, but God knew who would. God knew who was going to do works later on. No, that's why it says here, not because of works. Works done or works foreseen. Works have no role in this election. And I might also bring up this. Even as we looked at Abraham, and it wasn't that encouraging, what happens when we look at Isaac? Is he a super quality guy? What did he do to his brother when his brother was desperately hungry? He kind of manipulated him out of his birthright. You know. Now, that doesn't certainly exonerate his brother for doing it, but taking advantage of a brother at a time of need, at a time of crisis, that's not good stuff. And then what does he also further do? Yeah, he puts some sheep on his arm, puts on his brother's clothes, goes in and lies to his father and says that he's his brother, so that his father, who's now blind and near death, will put his hand on his head and give him the blessing and the birthright. He lied. Quality guy? No. Praise God, his election doesn't have to come to quality guys, because the scriptures have already told us if God should mark iniquity, no one could stand before him. You know? So the reality is this: when you see someone who is saved, it does not speak of any inherent quality that was ever theirs. What it says is, here is one who was a sinner just like the rest. All right. She was told, the older will serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob I loved, Esau I hated. One would be the object of God's love and specific care and blessing. The other one would not be the object of his special love and covenant care and blessing. And the scriptures, to explain the distinction between those two men and the two distinct relationships with God, the Holy Spirit chose to give us these strong terms. One of them, loved, and one of them hated. You know, some people say, "Well, I don't like that. I'm uncomfortable with that." Well, you're going to have to take that up with the Holy Spirit, because I didn't write these things. But it shows the strength of it. They're twins, the same mother, the same father, but it's so that we would understand that God has a right. And not only that, what God did is the opposite of what would have been logical. If God chose the second born. If he had chose the firstborn, Esau, everyone would have said, yeah, it makes sense. He chose the firstborn because the firstborn gets the birthright. And so God did it. Made his divine election contrary to culture, contrary to custom, contrary to every expectation of man, so that we would sit back and say what? God's election is the exercise of his own will. And not bound by men's culture, not bound by men's custom, not bound by anything else, but his own desires and purposes. All right, let's keep going. Further than that, so some people start to say, well, this is so challenging, so confusing. How does this work? And the whole purpose of Romans 9 is to establish God's election of these individuals in the Old Covenant, to point that forward to that is the exact way that God distributes his own mercy and compassion today, and the same way that God chooses to harden or punish others today. So then what, with regard to this idea of election, now go down to Romans 9 at the very bottom of the page for the second, the last verse on the bottom of page 2, to understand the context, because there are dear brothers and sisters who try their best to wrangle Romans 9 out of the Bible and try to somehow say, well, no, you've got to look at Romans 9 in the greater context of Romans 9 through 11. Absolutely you do. And so it's not talking, the election it's talking about here is not about salvation. It's about the Jews. It's about God electing the Jewish people. No. I mean, I know why they're saying that, and they have to say that, but they're ignoring what the scriptures say. Listen as I read Romans 9:24 right here, explaining to us what this issue of election is specifically referring to. It's referring to, and we're going to work our way back to this, but I want to give this now. Even us, whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles, the ethnos, the nations, the peoples. As indeed he says in Hosea, those who were not my people, I will call my people. And her who was not beloved, I will call beloved. And in that very place where it was said to them, you are not my people, they will be called sons of the living God. All right, so this election that's being referred to here is an election to sonship. That is that election. Again, in this context, you're coming out of Romans chapter 8 where you've had the declaration of adoption. This is salvation. This is redemption. And it's not just for the Jews, but it's to everyone who's called from among all the different people groups, including the Jews. Okay? It's to be a part of that new covenant family of God, where he would make for himself his own new covenant people in Christ Jesus. So then how does this work? How does this salvation work? How does this election work? Romans 9:16 explains it this way. So it depends not on human will. Really can't say it more clearly than that, can you? And what is the tragic, at least in this present day and age? You know, if we were to go back to the 1500s and 1600s, if we were to go back to the days of the apostles, if we were to go back to the first 300 years of the New Testament church, in different eras, you've had different beliefs as the majority belief system. Okay. In the early days of the church, it was always recognizing the sovereign will of God. In the days following the Reformation, the entire Protestant church recognized salvation as all of God's will, all of grace. But men continue to push their idea and their peculiar notions of free will. And then here you have this verse, Romans 9:16, that says it so wonderfully clear. It does not depend on what? Human will or exertion or effort. So in other words, it's not about man exercising his will. It's not about a man doing something. Then what is it? I mean, but what if when God called Abraham, he didn't come? What would have happened then? What do you mean if he called Abraham, he didn't come? When he called Abraham, he brought him. Oh, so he came because he brought him? Yes. And so everyone who exercises their will to come to him does so why? Because he brought them. Because he set their wills free from unrighteousness that was suppressing the truth. He set their hearts free from that slavery to sin. He gave them life in Christ Jesus, understanding by the Spirit of God, faith in that gospel. And they believed. They repented. And so not human will, not exertion, but on God who has mercy. And this is the shocking thing. We live in a day and age in which the majority of the present day, the modern Christian church, thinks the basis of salvation is men's will, their decisions, and man's efforts, their commitments. And the scripture says, no, not at all. Actually, have no part in it. Those things only come to life and come to work after what? The mercy of God is poured out on them in the person of the Holy Spirit, applying to them the benefits of all that Christ accomplished. And so, but it is on God who had mercy. And so here's the shocking thing. Too many are thinking, and maybe even I have to think of my own self. For too long I thought I was saved by my will. Means I made the right decision. I don't know, you know, I made my decision before I was 7 years old. I don't know why my brother waited till he was 20. You know, what was wrong with him? You know, and what was right with me? So I thought, silly guy. Wasn't that? I was, by God's grace, a recipient of his mercy while yet young. And not because of my will, not because of my work. He didn't look down and say, yeah, Jason deserves it more than his brother. He didn't say that. You know, possibly, if he would have looked, he might have seen one of my brothers as deserving more than me. Well, not really, because no one is deserving. Relatively better, but he will never look down and see someone deserving. See how easy it is to let your mind get messed up? You were that close. All right. So man is not saved by his desire to be saved. A man is not saved by his effort to be saved. The only people who will be saved are those who God sets his mercy on. That's it. So then around the room and ask people, why are you saved? And if their answer is anything but because of the mercy of God, then they don't yet understand. They may be saved by his grace, but they don't understand the richness of the salvation that is theirs. Now, very few of us in the earliest days of our conversion understand the powerful grace and the mechanisms of its working. You know, the way that it was often said is that sometimes when you're on this side, before salvation, you're looking and it's like there's a gatepost and a door there, and it says, whosoever will may come. You know, and you walk through there and thinking you did on your own, and you look back and on the top of the door it says, chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world. Oh, you mean I only came because he chose me, and actually he made me willing? He put that desire within me? Yes. Down to Romans 9:18. So then, he has mercy, that is, God has mercy on who? Whomever he wills. It's not whoever deserves it. It's not whoever tries harder. It's not whoever's going to respond better. It's all based on the will of God. This is what's so hard for people today. They're not ready to live in a world that functions entirely by the will of God. They want to elevate the will of man right there, as close as they can get it. Just maybe a slightly lesser tier. But that's not what the scripture says. He has mercy on whom he has mercy, and he does what? He hardens whomever he hardens. And to give that example, it says it in, if you're in your Romans chapter 9, you'll see that in verse 16. The scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed throughout all the earth. So this Pharaoh was raised up to power. Even before God sends Moses there, God to tell them, to tell Pharaoh to let the people go, he tells Moses in advance, I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart and he's not going to do it. And we would say, well, why would God do that? Well, we can't always know the reasons why, but here it gives us something of the reason why. For this purpose I've raised you up, that I might show my power in you and my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. I'm going to show that here you are the most powerful king, and your heart is going to be hardened, and I'm going to still force you to do what you don't want to do, and that's let the children of Israel go. And I'm going to bring them out, and I'm going to split that sea, and it's going to swallow you up in my wrath. Wait a second. So you're saying that the scriptures seem to be saying here that Pharaoh was born and Pharaoh existed and Pharaoh rose to significance and power, and the design of that by God was so that in his rebellious heart, God would continue to harden him as just condemnation for his sinfulness, and he will then not let the children of Israel go. And when finally God works his wonders of deliverance, God's ultimate purpose in bringing this man life and power and strength and influence is so that he can take him, pour out his wrath, and put him to death, that his power would be proclaimed all over the earth. Does that seem fair? So Pharaoh had to live and die just so that God's reputation of great power is proclaimed throughout the earth? That doesn't seem fair. Well, the reason why it may not seem fair is you're thinking that Pharaoh deserves anything, and you're thinking, you're almost as if you think Pharaoh and God are peers. They are not peers. What is Pharaoh? The work of God's hands. And remember, we forget, even as Romans 9, chapter 3, verse 9 and following continues to say, not only is none righteous, no one understands, no one seeks after God, it says we have altogether become worthless. This fellow, and that's what we have to understand. God redeemed me not because he saw redeeming characteristics or redeeming qualities, but all because of his mercy. And further, to make people even more struggling to deal with this, it says this in Romans 9:22. What if God? Now the phrase what if there is a day. It's not here in the sense of a condition. Well, what if? It's not a hypothetical here. The same words for that are translated here, what if, can easily be translated like this, since now. Okay? Because the word a is the word for if or since or because, and the word day can mean now, then, and a host of other things. So the what if here isn't a conditional phrase. It is since now God has desires to show his wrath. Well, someone might come in and say, well, God would never desire to show his wrath. It just finished telling you that's why he raised up Pharaoh in order to show his wrath. So yes, he would. We might even go so far as to say, what about Judas? So Judas was born, lived his entire life, only to what? Betray Jesus, and then take his own life. Wow, that's harsh. But that's the truth. What if God, desiring to show his wrath and to make known his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction? Pharaoh was a vessel of wrath prepared for destruction. Now we got to notice that. Remember this. We were all by nature children of wrath like the rest. We were all deserving of destruction. Don't miss that. But what's interesting to notice about this is though that's what we deserved, even then they benefited from God's mercifulness, his loving kindness, in that some patience. Because though Pharaoh deserved destruction and wrath from the beginning, I guarantee you he experienced his fair share of earthly pleasures. Being the Pharaoh, he had a lot of the things that he would have wanted. All the fleshly delights of food and all the pleasures that could be known, I'm sure he knew them to a larger degree than maybe Moses ever did. But what? He was an object of wrath, prepared for destruction. In order, the purpose, to make known the riches of his glory to vessels of mercy. There are two kinds of people in the whole world. Here they are given under the term vessels. And vessels in terms of what they are prepared, fitted, designed, destined for. There are vessels of wrath that are what? Prepared for destruction. And then there are vessels of mercy that are prepared for what? Prepared beforehand for glory. Now it's interesting to note that the difference between one and another is what? The mercy of God. This is so beautiful because it's not simply what you, it's not vessels of destruction and vessels of glory. It's not simply to the end. It's vessels of wrath and vessels of mercy. Because when you understand that by his grace we are vessels of mercy, then we understand we were by nature children of wrath. And we would have rightly been left in that camp until our destruction, but because of mercy. Not by human will or exertion, by God's mercy. Let's keep going. Now this is going to make people feel uncomfortable. Now I hope you're in Romans 9 in your Bibles. Because Paul deals with this, the fact that it makes people uncomfortable. And he says this, after he says, so then he has mercy on whom he will have mercy, he'll harden whom he harden. Romans 9:19 says this, you will say to me then, why does he still find fault? For who can resist his will? Paul, if your theology, if what you're saying is what you're saying, then how in the world is God going to judge Pharaoh guilty when he is the one who purposed his hardening? And that's how our minds and our hearts react. If ultimately this was the purpose and design of God, then he must be the one at fault. All right? The Holy Spirit led Paul to ask that very question, to present that very challenge. And it says this, "For who can resist his will?" In other words, if God has determined everything, what direction each one's going, then it's on him and none of it's our fault. But that's not true. God judges men for their own sins. Men are, by nature, children of wrath because of the condemnation that's come upon men because of Adam. And that is a just condemnation. And further, look what it says if I keep reading. "For who will resist his will?" And here's how Paul, indeed the Holy Spirit, indeed God answers that kind of a, "I don't get it, I don't understand, it doesn't seem fair." This is how God answers that. Verse 20. "Who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Will what is molded say to its molder, 'Why have you made me like this?' Can you really blame God?" Well, listen to what it says in verse 21. "Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump?" Because this is, again, an allusion way back kind of to the formation in the garden. God's formed man out of the dust of the ground, breathes him in the breath of life. Does God, who formed man, who made them all, not have a right to do what he wants with what he made? Yeah. Well, look what it says. "Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump?" All right, so those who are saved, those who receive mercy, did not come from a better lump. All right, we're not from a better original stock. We're not from more quality dust. "Out of the same lump, one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use." Okay, now again, that kind of language can be a little bit confusing for us, but let me put it in this way. They did not, those were not the same modern days. They didn't have even technically outhouses. They didn't have technically bathrooms and plumbing and running water. And so they would make vessels that could function like chamber pots, right? I'm not getting any more graphic than this. This is all I get. So you go back and look up chamber pots if you don't know what that is, all right? Or bedpans. You go look those things up. If the person who makes these things chooses to use a gold-covered, beautifully engraved chamber pot, and then take another one that's tarnished, unattractive, and put flowers in that and put that on the shelf, should we put him in jail? Has he done something wrong? Does he need to go and apologize to the gold chamber pot? Yes or no? No! Because he can do what he wants with it. He made it. It's his. And whether or not it makes sense to us, he gets to do what he wants. And this is what the scripture is saying. And that's why not many wise, not many noble. I mean, there are going to be some, by earthly standards, wise men, noble men, handsome and beautiful people who are ultimately passed over, left in their sin, are not the ones who receive mercy. That you would think when the final day comes, why me and not him? I mean, you would have thought that you would have wanted to stack the eternal kingdom with the attractive ones and, whatever. Those are our thoughts, and we begin to, but we can't figure it out. But God has the rights to make one for honorable use and one for dishonorable use. And that's his right. And he exercises that right. And it goes on to say, this honorable use and dishonorable use is that God demonstrated in the same lump from the same origin that began in Adam, vessels of wrath and vessels for mercy, for destruction and for glory. Got a problem with that? Well, it's tough. But who are you, O man, to answer back to God? And even, it just removes all of those sense of confusion, all of those sense of excuses. We cannot, and I'll tell you that there are those who will say that, well, this is not fair. You can't, when something's hard to understand and something's hard to accept, you can't just default to who are you to answer back to God? Who are you to question God? So, well, that's what the Holy Spirit said through the apostle with the authority of Christ behind it. Yes, that's what we have to ask ourselves. Yes, that's what we have to understand. And there is an answer to that. Who are you? I am no one, and I will not question God. I will simply accept the truth that he has given to us and revealed. Now, how does this happen? All right? Listen, so page 3, moving on down. Everyone who truly repents and believes will be saved. Okay, we all believe that from both sides of this camp, but who will repent? Who will believe? Only those elected or chosen, appointed to receive God's mercy. Let's see that. God chose, and let's walk through a few verses, and we're probably not going to get through all of it again, but that's all right. In Acts chapter 2, verse 39, this is on the day of Pentecost, so this is one of those first gospel presentations after the ascension of Christ by the apostles, right? This promise is for you, so this promise is for those Jews who are sitting there listening, and for your children, it's for the descendants of the Jews who are to come, and for what? All who are far off. All right, so if it's for the Jews, those who are going to be their children, and for everyone who's far off. Now, who's it for? Everybody. And what is this gospel? What is this thing that's for everybody? You must repent and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, which was an expression of your faith in Christ. And who's going to do that? Who's going to repent and be baptized in faith? Who's going to do that? Well, some of the Jews, some of their children, some of those who are far off. And here's how the scriptures explain which among them will do that. Everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. In Acts chapter 13, verse 48, it says this, when the Gentiles heard this, they rejoiced, glorifying the word of the Lord, and listen, as many as were appointed or ordained, assigned to eternal life, believed. So who believed? Those who were appointed to eternal life. You know who never will believe? Those who weren't appointed. And the appointment, the basis for that appointment is what? God's mercy, God's purposes, God's will. Not ours. Ephesians 1, 4 through 6, that's why it says, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him in love, he predestined, and again, notice, us. Now, who's the us in Ephesians? The saints in Ephesus who are faithful. This is not mankind. The chosen are the saints. So much more. You can read the rest of those verses. Jump over with me, if you would, to page 4. Because this is where I start flying through an important summary. All I need to do is hit the topic and you get to hit the rest of these scriptures yourself. When did he choose? First answer is before we did anything, right? And we saw that demonstrated in his choice of one twin over another. But he chose not only before we did anything, but he actually chose before anyone did anything. Because when did he make this choice? Before creation. Ephesians 1:4 says he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. In 2 Timothy 1:9 it says, which he gave us in Christ Jesus, which was not by our works. We received that holy calling. He gave us in Christ Jesus before ages began. Revelation 13:8, all who dwell on the earth will worship it. That is the beast and the false prophet. Everyone whose name has not been written in the Lamb's book of life, but has been written, everyone whose name has not been written before the foundation of the world in the book of life of the Lamb that was slain. So this book is written when? Anyone? Before the foundation of the world. And they are those who are alive at the time of the Antichrist, who will not follow after him and not worship him, are only who? The ones who were elect in Christ before the foundation of the world. They will be kept in faith from following the deceiver and the enemies. Again, all this, again, written in the book of life from the foundation of the world and so on. So don't let somebody confuse you. Sometimes people try to paint this picture that the Lamb's book of life is somehow the moment you walk forward in a church and then repeat a few words after somebody in prayer, that somehow your name is now being written in the Lamb's book of life in heaven. That is not the case. When was it written? Before ages began, before the foundation of the world. And the reason why you came was because your name is written. He gave you to his son, the lamb that was slain. The son came and he purchased you. He sent the spirit that he will call you and draw you, and you will come. You will be granted that you will hear the Savior's voice. He will call his own by name. And what do the sheep do when they hear him? They follow him, and he gives unto them eternal life. He calls them by name. You know who's not going to follow? Those who aren't his sheep, who don't get called by name. This is not confusing. The whole of scriptures continue to teach these things. I mean, we're in the Old Testament, the New Testament, the epistles, the gospels. It's everywhere. I remember when someone once tried to tell me, there's a few verses here and there that teach election. That's just crazy. The sovereignty of God and his selective purposes and mercy is replete through the scriptures. What is the basis of his choice? Nothing in us and nothing that we do. It was nothing in Abraham. It's nothing in us. It's all God. Top of page 5, he saved us not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. And it's when that happens, the Holy Spirit comes and does that works, that we then repent and believe and think we did it. But the scripture teaches us otherwise, so that we learn to glory in the God of our salvation. So that we can say, as Titus 3:5 says, he saved us. Not, oh, I would have been lost if I hadn't made my decision. No. He saved you. You didn't save yourself. No one did. Why? According to his purpose and according to his will, whomever he wills, that he predestined according to the purpose of him. 2 Timothy tells us, verse 1:9, he saved us with a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace. Well, what is his purpose in saving us? Well, everyone condemned to wrath everyone rightly under destruction, but he would make some of those vessels of mercy in order that we might know the riches of his mercy and grace, that we would resound to his glory forever. What if we don't understand it? What if this is hard to accept? Well, even if we don't like it and we don't understand it, it's God. And we simply have to take God at his word, because he alone knows who he is. He alone knows what he's done. He alone has the rights to do what he does and tell us what he's done. And so again, down to the bottom of page 6, there are those that it says these are specifically, faith and repentance are specifically given to the chosen or the elect or saints. In Colossians 1, 26 and 27, which is down towards the very bottom of page 6, it says this: the mystery, hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. You know who it's not revealed to? Mankind, every single person in the world. This salvation, this gospel is revealed, uncovered, shown, manifest to his saints. To them, God chose to make known how great among the peoples are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you. Who gets to know the riches of this mystery, Christ in you? The saints. Not everyone. Titus 1:1 says this: Paul, a servant of God and apostle of Jesus Christ. How does Paul ultimately understand the real purpose of his earthly ministry and calling? For the sake of the faith of God's elect and their knowledge of the truth. He doesn't for one moment think that he's going to somehow win someone to faith who's not elect. Now, he doesn't have an advanced copy of the Lamb's Book of Life. You don't, and I don't. And the beauty of what we're seeing here is this: we can't look at anybody on anything about them, the way that they're presently living, anything, and say, there's no way his name's in that book. No way. We can't say that. Because there are a multitude of people whose names have been proven by his grace, converting them to be in that book. And this is why, you know, it starts to get turned around to the other side. This doesn't seem fair. Why would God leave this person in his sin and not save them? I don't understand that. Well, we could also sometimes look and say, why, God, why'd you have mercy on him? Why'd you have mercy on her? You know, think how challenging it is if there's someone who's come in and brutalized, massacred, abused, done something horrible to you, to your family, to your loved ones, and then in the timing and purposes of God, he brings that person to repentance and salvation. You might think, no, God, how dare you have mercy on him? There's, from whatever side, there's always going to be somebody questioning, it's not right to have mercy on that guy. God, how could you not have mercy on him? How could you? You know, and we will get confused on both sides. But we don't have that list. But you know what we're called? A debtor to all, to take the gospel to all. Why do we take the gospel to everybody? Because everyone we see and everyone we meet might be one of God's sheep. Through our sharing of the gospel, it might be the day that they are ordained unto salvation and that they are called out. We go and we proclaim, because through the proclamation of the gospel, God brings his elect to himself. Well, couldn't God do it without the gospel? Sure. Could God light the world without the sun? Sure. I mean, we could go on all day with the things God could not. I mean, it's nonsense. This is the way that God does it. And so we take the gospel to the ends of the earth. And we do it with confidence because he's already told us that he has elected for himself out of every tongue, tribe, and nation. Which means wherever we go and we have a desire to take that gospel to the ends of the earth, why? Because we know that he has his people among all the peoples. And so for the sake of the faith of God's elect. Well, so are you, and this is the argument you'll also hear. So are you saying that the elect will be saved no matter what they do? No. The elect will be saved because of what God does. And because of what God does, they will come in genuine repentance and faith and follow Christ, loving him above all else. They will. The idea of election isn't that somehow God saves people apart from the gospel, isn't that somehow people are saved no matter what they do. They're saved because of what God does, and that then affects everything that they do moving forward. Those are mischaracterizations. You guys just think that God's going to save the elect and no matter what they do. No, no. He's going to bring them to faith and repentance. He's going to draw them willingly. To some it is given, others are passed over. All of this by the perfect design of God. And so, in conclusion of today's consideration, please, you can read the rest of those scriptures. They all continue to repeatedly build up the same themes and the same ideas. And so this is the simple thing that we're at in terms of a basic summary. Mankind, as created because of Adam's sin, what was the result? Condemnation passed on all men. All men are then born by nature children of wrath, and God would be right and to give them all over to destruction. But God has determined in love, before the foundation of the earth, to have mercy on a multitude of people, so that there would not just be a world full of nothing but vessels of wrath. There would be a world full of people that are by nature children of wrath, but they would, many of them would come in the process of time to be the recipients of God's mercy. And so there would be vessels of wrath and vessels of mercy, so that when all is said and done, you can read Matthew chapter 25. He says to the sheep, he separates the sheep and the goats. He separates the vessels of wrath from the vessels of mercy. And he says, come and inherit the kingdom prepared for you by my Father before the foundation of the world. Enter my joy. You go to the place of destruction prepared for you. There's no surprises from God's side. And so our responsibility is to set aside our judgments and our expectations and to a degree our emotions and listen and learn to what God says. And when we do, it humbles us so much. We begin to think, I'm only saved because of the mercies of God. And we plead with him, oh God, that you might have mercy on my family, that you might have mercy on my loved ones. And we pray because there's no other hope of salvation apart from his mercy. And if there was not electing mercy set on some, there would be none in heaven. The number is not changed. The list is written before the foundation of the world. It's not, someone will said, so the from the other side in conclusion, so this person, because he's not elect, he's going to go to hell no matter what he does? Well, here's the truth of it. No, he's going to go to hell because of what he does. Well, but what if he believes? Well, he can because he's dead in his trespasses and sin. He doesn't understand. Well, what if he tries? What if he decides? Look, it's not on human will or exertion. Men in their sin will not. So no one is going to be rejected no matter what they do. All will be condemned because of what they do. In the final day of judgment, the books are open and the judgment is rendered to men for deeds done in the body. Okay? So no one on that last day is pointing fingers. It was ultimately your fault. As they come in the presence of the holy God, to see themselves recognize their own sinfulness. Yeah, someday every knee will bow and tongue confess, he is Lord. He's the righteous judge. And they will be cast out. And so that is a simple overview of election. And we'll see how these things even move into the work of Christ and other things as the weeks unfold. Take this, read through it. Read the scriptures, pray, because it is the scriptures. Indeed, we all must be taught by God, not by men. And God, by his word, by his spirit, even at times using men, teaches us. So go back, open your Bibles, pray, and ask him to reveal to you what is true. Lord, as we close, we just ask for that grace, that you would illumine our hearts and minds. Lord, that we would hear your word and that we would hear it with faith. Lord, that we would not be those who would ever be found fighting against your word. It astounds me how, as a young believer, I loved you and I loved your word, but I did not know these things, and they seemed like they couldn't be. But I thank you, Lord, that through the years and through the richness of your word and the power of your spirit, you've made these things so clear. And we thank you that you've not just put them here and there in obscure verses that are hard to understand and confusing, but you explain it, you repeat it, you apply it, you express it over and over again so that we might set aside our own pride, set aside our own egos, and humbly acknowledge we are saved because you saved us. We stand where we stand because of your mercy and your grace alone. We thank you for our Savior, Jesus Christ, who you sent for us, who accomplished all that we could never do. Lord, our hope is in you and in you alone. In Jesus' name, amen.